Welcome back, everyone. This is episode 2 of the 4 episodes, or maybe more. You never know. Okay. So we left off where we had actual connectivity between our servers, or our server, and the default gateways of all the VLANs. This is our core switch, which it's a root bridge. It's our BTP server. These are BTP clients. We have switch port security. We get all that. Just verify, because one of the things I always like to do is verify, okay, to make sure that I still have connectivity to all my VLANs, all right, or to wherever I was pinging before, 32.54, which is my gateway, and I do, up arrow, 20.254, and I do, awesome, control C, and then I go ahead and let's see here, 10.254. and 1.254. That's VLAN 1, because we do have a VLAN 1 on our router. Oh, that's 54, so that's not gonna work. I'm gonna do control C. It's 254. Come on, fingers, don't fail me now. All right, you can see I give myself a little bit more room to work with. Let me bring this lab up a little bit. It's like hiding down there. Just bring it a little bit more to the side here. All right. So we come into our router, we open it up, okay? We wanna make sure we open this up. Keep it right there, all right? And we do a show IP, let's enable, show IP route. Okay, and you see that we're connected to all our VLANs in there, show IP in brief. Know these commands. All right, there's all our sub interfaces. You see we have a VLAN 1 interface. Why do I know it's VLAN 1? Because remember I said visually, I do this. So since we have that, we know we have connectivity, let's bring out an IT person. All right, let's bring out a laptop and let's go ahead and connect them. We won't cheat. We'll use a straight through cable, F00, and we'll just plug them into port 15. Just to give it a port, I'm gonna fast forward through time. All right, because I'm tired of all that. All right, so that's VLAN 1. So we're gonna give him static IP address. We're gonna give him a static IP address for that particular VLAN. Okay, no worries there. 192.168.168.1.1. Tap. 192.168.1. Okay, period. 1.254, and the DNS server is going to be 30.1. So we're going to go 192.168.30.1. Awesome. So we know we should, right? Get to it. 192.168.30.1. Why am I using the IP address? There it is. LazAlphaPass, because we never configured DNS on this. Let me just show you real quick. If you want to configure DNS on the server, you come here, you're gonna say las.com. All right, doesn't matter, uppercase, lowercase, the IP address of the DNS server, which is the server itself. You click add. All right, I select this down here. I click save. All right, we already did all the changes, but look here, don't forget, see how that's off? Make sure you turn that on, or else it's not gonna happen. All right, and then you go to the desktop, go here. Type las.com. Boom! Resolving las.com. So let's go back to the laptop. Alright, is this gonna be your CCNA? Obviously not. But just so you have fun with it, so you can see, you know, what you can do. And there we go, we have resolution, because when you create access lists, which we will in other episodes to come, we will be blocking port 80. So there you go, port 80. Alright, so what we're gonna do now? Alright, we have connectivity across there. So, but these PCs don't have IP addresses, so we need to configure DHCP. Now remember, DHCP has a process, it's called DORA. DORA the Explorer, right? D-O-R-A, right? DORA, meaning Discover, Offer, Request, Acknowledge. The problem with that is that D-O-R-A, that D, is that Discover is a broadcast. It's a broadcast, which routers don't like. That's why we have our little buddy, the IP helper address. Yeah, I'm gonna get myself squared away here, look professional for everybody. All right, so we have the IP helper address that will help, that if you're in some other segment of the network, you can get an IP address, and we'll see how that works. All right, but here on this particular scenario, we're all connected to the same router, so we don't need the IP helper address. So what we do need is to configure DHCP on this router. So let's do that. Okay. So we're gonna go ahead. Can't get out of the recording area. Gotta make sure we stay within the recording area. Okay, there we go. All right, so we're gonna go ahead and configure DHCP for VLANs 10 and 20, I believe. Let me move this out of the way. Yes, for VLANs 10 and VLAN 20. Really don't need VLAN 30 or VLAN 1. We could, I mean, we could create those pools as well if we wanted to, in case you want to plug in any computers and get an IP address. Why not? Let's go ahead. First, I like to create the exclusions. The IP addresses that I don't want allocated. Terminology. We all say, hey, I got an IP address assigned. No, no, no. Cisco says, an IP address, you were allocated. Ah, test questions. Okay. So, we go IP, DHCP, and then you have an option. Exclude addresses, pool, relay. All right, so we're going to do exclude addresses. All right, now it'll ask you for a low IP address or a high IP address because you can create an actual range if you wanted to. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to create individual. So I'm going to say, okay, I want to not allocate 192.168.10.254. Why? Because that's my router. All right, I'm going to up arrow. I say I don't want to allocate 20.254. I don't want to allocate 30.254. Those are my default routers. Those are my default gateways. I don't want to allocate 30.1. That's my DNS server, right? Static. Can't allocate that address, okay? And I don't want to allocate 1.254. That's for VLAN 1. I don't want to allocate that. And the IP, the IT individual has 1.1. So, hey, let's go ahead and put that as an exclusion as well because we don't want it to allocate that particular address. So we've taken all the VLANs and we said, hey, do not allocate these IP addresses because they already are taken up by somebody. It's in use. All right, so let's create the pool. IP, DHCP pool. Now, what is the name of each one? I know each switch has a particular name. We'll call it VLAN 10, 20, 30, and so forth. So IP DHCP pool for VLAN 10. Okay, and I'm gonna do a question mark here so you can see all the things that we need. For the CCNA exam, if you even have to configure this, let me just ask you questions about it. But if you have to configure it, that's why I put the question mark, so you don't forget. Okay, I need to put the default router, that is for VLAN 10. All right, what's the default router's IP address? 192.168.10.254. Okay. What's the DNS server? DNS tab 192.168.30.1. Okay. Domain name. Oh, whoops. I forgot a period there. You know, my fingers don't want to help me anymore. All right. Domain name. It's last.com. Okay. And then the network that we belong to is the 192.168.10.0.255.255.255.0. Enter. Cool. All right, we got the default router address. We got the DNS. We made a little error there. We forgot the little period, so that's why it gave us a caret symbol. All right, so we just fixed it here. We put our domain name. Do we have to? No, but we will. And then 192.168.10.0. Okay, cool. So we got 10 done. All right, so I'm gonna exit out and do a new pool. IP, DHCP pool for VLAN 20. Oh, no S spaces. Okay, so we're gonna go ahead and do our little question mark here to keep ourselves organized, know what to do. All right, so we go default router, 192.168.20.254. That's our default gateway. All right, DNS. Server is 192.168.30.1. Okay. Our domain name is last.com. All right. Then we got the network. What network do we belong to? 192.168.20.0, 255.255.255.0. All right. So we got VLAN 20. Let's do VLAN 30. All right. So I'm going to exit out of this pool, create a new pool, IP, DHCP pool, VLAN, no spaces. Tricked me again. All right. New default router, 192.168.30.254. Okay. So VLAN 30. VLAN 30. All right. Then we go, who's the DNS server? That's me, 192.168.30.30.1. What's the domain name? What's last.com, dude? All right, network, 192.168.30.0, 255.255.255.0. Booyah. All right, and hey, we can't forget about VLAN 1, right? Let's just give it a little DHCP pool in case we decide to put other computers in there. So we're gonna go ahead and say IP, exit out once, go back to global, IP, DHCP pool, say VLAN uno, number one, all right? Which is usually the management VLAN, the native VLAN, whatever you wanna call it, administrator VLAN, IT VLAN, the VLAN in charge, you know, whatever terminology you wanna use. So those are keywords when you're looking at a test or untagged or tagged frames. Right, untagged, native VLAN. Tagged, not made in VLAN. All right, so we're gonna do question mark, default router, 192.168.1.254. And then we go DNS server, it's 192.168.30.1, domain name, lags.com. Network is 192.168.1.0, 255.255.255.0. Enter. Now I'm gonna do it the way you're supposed to do it when you're in the exam. Copy, run, start. Yes, when you go to the real world, you need to do this. No, just do WR, whatever command, you know, shortcut command you can use, right? They're different between routers. Okay, and depending on the series or router, you may just have to type save and then say yes, and stuff like that. So it doesn't really matter. So let's take a look. Show start. All right, there it is right there. There's our exclusions that we created first. Here's our VLAN. Let's just check it. This is VLAN 10. 10 is the network. 10 is the key field gateway. 301 is the DNS. Awesome. We got that. VLAN 20. 20 is the network. 20 is the gateway. 301 is the DNS. All right, there's your domain name there. Beautiful. Then we have VLAN 30. 30 is the 30 is the network. 30.24. 30.1 is the DNS server. And then VLAN 1. 1.0 is the network. 24. Why am I doing this? Because I want to make sure that I did it correctly. All right. And let's see if we start getting IP addresses assigned. Let's go to this computer. And look, we got an IP address. 20.1 dynamically the DHCP. Yeah, and there's the DNS server. So that means if I'm getting an IP address, I should be able to go last.com and boom, there it is. Boom, there it is. No. All right, desktop. And then again, last.com. Whoa, we didn't even look at that. We didn't even check if we got an IP address. We just assumed it because we're that good. All right, so we're gonna go in there and say last.com. All right, so we're doing that. So let's see, this guy is static. Let's just put a PC, an actual PC in there. All right, to see if he's gonna get an IP address because all the ports here are part of VLAN 1. So let's see if he gets an actual VLAN 1 address. All right, let's just plug him into whichever port. Let's plug him into port 4, whatever. Let's come here. Let's change him to this. We'll close this. Leave that open. We'll fast forward through time. Why do we want to fast forward through time? Because we want to make sure that it does what it's got to do. We don't have to wait 90 seconds, 120, 80 minutes. You know, we want to make sure we get things done right away. Go to the IP configurations, and there you go. We got the second available one because the first one we excluded it. So we should be able to. Wow. Last.com, and there you are. So we have configured successfully our DHCP server for multiple VLANs. No need for IP helper address because all this is connected to the router. Yes, you are creating sub interfaces. Yes, these are different segments, but they're all connected to the router, who is the DHCP server. So you're all pointing to the DHCP server. There is no need for an IP helper address unless you go beyond that point. Now, one thing that we haven't done and we need to do is we need to create an IP address, a management address for each one of these switches. All right. So we need to do that. So we're going to go ahead and do that. We're going to do that for VLAN 1. So we need to exclude it. So we're going to have to exclude it. We need to go back to make sure that we have no conflicts with the DHCP server. All right. So we need to make sure that we exclude those addresses, which I never did. I mean, I can create. We're going to keep it in the same, and I'll just create an exclusion for it. I'll make a range, a low and a high. As a matter of fact, let's do that now. Let's go into VLAN 1. Well, not really. Config T. You don't need to do that. Enable config T. Config T. Okay. IP, DHCP, and then exclude addresses. Remember, it says low address 192.168.1.250. And then space 192.168.1.254. Right? And UWR. Ooh, sorry. It's just, you know, it's custom. Copy, run, start. Okay. So we do a show start. Now we see we did it individually first. And look, I'm putting it again here. 254. Well, 10 to do. Or this for VLAN 1. Okay. But with VLAN 1, we did it here too. So no big deal. It's not going to hurt anything. All right, we're excluding it. So here we did individual, here we did a range. A low IP address, a high IP address. All right, because we're gonna go into the switches now. Let's go to the core. All right, let's open the core up. But we're only gonna do it for VLAN 1 because VLAN 1 is still the management VLAN, okay? So we're gonna give it an IP address. So we can go inside the switch and manage it, tweak it, do whatever we need to do. There is no CLI tab in there, okay, in the real world. So we go in here and we say int VLAN 1 IP address 168.1. Now our gateway is 1.24, so this will be 253. I go backwards, 255.255.255.0. We have to turn it on. No shut. And then we exit and we give it an IP default hyphen gateway, which is 192.168.1.254. And let me tell you why. All right. A little itchy here. Let me tell you why. Because according to Cisco, which is true, all right, Cisco doesn't lie. If you are remote to your segment, all right? None of these computers are remote to their segment because they're all connected to the same router. But if you're connected somewhere else, okay, you're remote to your segment, you will not be able to go inside the switch if you don't have a default gateway. You can go through it, you know, you can ping, so you can ping the destination address, but you can't get inside it if you're remote to that segment, okay? If you're remote. Just letting you know the reason behind using a default gateway address. Keep that in mind. We don't have to copy that. So we're gonna, we do. All right, so that's Control Shift 6. You see, I was trying to use a DNS server. We have one. They say, hey, let me look for a DNS server. What is that? So it's a typo. Control Shift 6. All right, do WR. All right, so that's the core switch. So we're gonna go now to this switch here and open it up. CLI. Our accounting switch. Enable conf T into VLAN 1. IP address 192.168.1.252. 2. Where was that going? 255, that 255, that 255, that 0. No shut. Exit. Okay. And then we're going to do a IP default IP gateway 192.168.1.254. Enter. All right. Do WR. Awesome. Let's go to the next one. Let's not waste any time. We're going to get this up and running and going. I'm not doing it for the VLANs that are there. I'm just doing it for a particular VLAN, which is VLAN 1, because it's the management. All right, so we're going to enable, config T. Okay, we're going to say int VLAN 1, IP address 192.168.1.255.255.0. And then we say no shut, we exit, IP default hyphen gateway 192.168.1.254, enter, DWR. And remember, it's a video, so pause, take a snapshot, whatever, snippet, look at it, record it, slow it down, whatever you need to do. All right, so you can go ahead and practice this. You better practice it. You better understand why we're doing this. Hey, we never named this switch. Do show VLAN brief. This is the finance. Alright, because all the ports are in the finance. So let's do host name real quick. Finance. WR. Alright, so int VLAN 1. IP address 192.168.1.250. 255.255.255.0. No shut. And then we go exit once. And then we do IP default hyphen gateway 192.168.1.254. Enter. Here we are. So we can test this. And let's do the telnet lines. Let's say the finance switch. Let's go ahead and do that. Conf T. Line con 0, right? And now we go at con 0. Exit line VTY 0 space 15. Password Cisco. Login. Right? DWR. Done. So we just turned on the telnet lines just to see if we can telnet. Okay, so I'm on laptop. I'm in VLAN 1. I want to telnet to, what's that, 251? 250? So telnet 192.168.1.250 and then Cisco CISCO and we're in the finance switch. So you want to make sure that you have an IP address. I didn't just say anything. You want to have an IP address on your switches for managing. Why are people still buying non-managed switches? I have no freaking clue. Okay. You need to have managed switches. You can go inside them and manage them. Unless you're managing them through a third-party software, through your browser, or whatever the case may be. All right, cool. But somehow you're managing that particular device. You have to, because you need to configure all these different things so your network can be effective. If you're not doing all the things that we're doing here, your network will not be effective, okay? It will just run amok. Right, you want to do that. All right, now what I'm going to do here, I'm going to add, because we already did the DHCP and I showed you about the default gateways and stuff like that, and I'm putting an IP address on the switch. I'm going to do a little bit of routing, not too much. Okay, so I'm just going to add another router in here. This is a 2911, that's what we're using. So in our part to be routing, at least in my eyes, I'll put it up here. Okay. And then I'll put one down here. Okay. In my eyes, in order to route, you need, you know, more than two routes. Okay. So we do crossover cables. This is G01. We'll put to G00. Now we'll do G01 to G02. All right. So, let's go ahead and make up a actual network for this. This would be the 10.1.1.4 CIDR 30. Okay. And then this will be point to point, right? 10.1.1.8 CIDR 30. So this is a discontinuous network. Oh boy. Because we have a class C and our class A, you know, there's no order to this. It's discontinuous whatsoever. So now the routing protocol, the first one we're going to do is we're going to do static routes. In this type of network, really, these are considered sub routers. All right. So we can do default routes here and here. All right. Or we can just do straight out static routes. And that's exactly what we're going to do. We're going to do static routes. We're going to do floating static routes. What in the world is that? Floating static routes is simply change the administrative distance so they can act as backup routes. Right? If one fails, the other one takes over. Or if the routing protocol that we'll use fail, that will take over. Okay. So let's go here. Let's first put the IP addresses on there. Let's turn this on, shall we? So G01. All right, so we need to go in here. Control C. Config T, int G0/1, and then we'll do IP address. It's 10.1.1.5. That's how you should be able to subnet and know what it is, okay? That quick, no shut. Okay, you wanna put a description, that's completely up to you. All right, it's nice, it's courteous, it's cool, but not, you know, recommended, not required. You're not twisting your arm to do this. Okay, so this is G00. Okay, so let's put the CLI. I'm gonna have to bring this up here. So let's do this. Let's bring the lab this way. There you go. The lab this way. So I can bring this over here. You guys can see. All right, and we'll say yes. Okay, yes. Really? Oh no, I want to say no. Control C. There you go. I'm out of it. All right. This is router 2. And let me get rid of this because people get confused. All right, this is R1. This will be R2. Okay, R2. And this will be R3. Because I call this 1, 2, and 3, and then they say, yeah, but the legal says, okay, dude, or do that. All right, it is what it is. This is R1. Okay, and we're doing G00. Okay, and this is 10.1.16. Oh, wait, I already did this. It's 10.15. I'm sorry. We're doing R2, which is G00. Yeah. Alright, so let's do R2. Enable config T. Nope. Config T. Let's do a host name, R2. And then we're gonna say int G01. I gotta check it again because I'm just no, it's not one, it's zero. G00. Very good. Very good, Lars. Very good. IP address. It's age. Ladies and gentlemen, age. 6.255.255.252. First one, I hit the button. 252. And then no shots. No shot. You can somebody at me say, hey, why is he putting a clock rate? Because I don't have serials. I have Ethernet cable. All right. Then we go to int G01. IP address. Let me go 10.1.1.9. All right, and that's gonna be 255.255.255.252. Enter, no shut. WR. Let's check. WR. Let's check it. Show protocols. Protocols. All right. If you have 10.1.16, all right, G00 that way. 10.1.9 going the other way. We can actually ping. 10.1.1.5, which is our neighbor. We can get a ping. Come on. So you're connected directly to it. I mean, seriously. All right. So we're good there. And then we get the last router, which is this guy right here, router 3. Okay. No, we don't want to enter the initial configuration dialog or setup mode. Enable config T, host name, R3. Okay, I'm gonna do IP address. Okay, no. Okay, go inside the interface to do that. face G0/2, and we'll do IP address. It's 10.1.1.10, 255.255.255.252, and then just no shut it. All right, so we're right here. So if we look at the routing table, show IP route, it only knows about the people who it's connected to. Routers only know who they're connected to directly. That's it. That's all they know. Who am I connected to directly? Other than that, they have no freaking clue. So if we're gonna do a static route, we need to tell it, yo, these networks exist beyond this point, okay? So we're gonna tell it what networks exist beyond this doorway right here, right? So a whole bunch of networks that exist out there, we need to let them know. So how do we do that? We can put a default route we want to. I'll just show you, because it's not gonna hurt it. The default route is basically the gateway of last resort. Because if you look at your IP route right now, your routing table, it tells you gateway resort is not set. So we can go ahead and set the gateway of last resort, okay? So if it gets a destination address that's not on the routing table, it'll go ahead and use the gateway of last resort and just send it. Hey, listen, I don't see it on the routing table, okay? Send it to the next router, maybe he knows where it's at. It won't drop the packet. That's the whole point of a default route. That's the whole point. Now you real world guys, taking a test, can you have multiple default routes? Yeah, you can change administrative distance, one fails, one's there, one fails, one's there. But that's why we use redundancy protocols. Okay? So one default route, okay? One default route pointing in one direction, that's it. Static routes can point in any direction. All right, so here we go, default route. IP route, 0000, and I want it to go out my G02 interface. Okay, now it's telling me, hey, whoa, dude, it's going out your exit interface. You may have some issues. It's fast Ethernet, so it has ARP. So it's gonna start creating ARP, so you may have some problems. And we're like, it's all right, man, it's okay, we got it, thank you. All right, so that's what a default gateway is. All right, and we'll look at it in a little bit. Now we're gonna do a static route to the networks that we don't know about. Okay, so we're gonna do config T. No, we're there. We're gonna do IP route. I don't know about the 10.1, no, that's 100, 10.1.1.4, all right? That has a 255.255.255.252, okay? I wanna go there, I'll be able to go there. Well, how do I get out? Your G02 interface. That's how you get out. Oh, okay. But I'm gonna put an administrative distance of 150. It's gonna be my backup. All right. Type that in there. What's another one I don't know about? Well, you definitely don't know about the 192.168.10.0.255.255.255.0. So you gotta go out the same interface, okay? You gotta get out that doorway so you can, you know, get to that network. All right, and we're gonna do the 20 and the 30. Yeah, go here, same interface, but this time this will be 20 and 30. Then, you know, up arrows, up arrows. We haven't done administrative commands yet. But we will. 30, and then we have one. Look, we forgot about the one DNN. All right, so we do this. And we'll just put here 1.0. All right. So we just told this particular router all these networks that are beyond its point. So if we look at the routing table now, show IP route. All right, we see all these static routes. We see the gateway of last resort. It's set now. Cool. So if it has a destination network that it's not on the routing table, it won't drop it. It'll just send it to the next router. It'll send it out that interface and hey, here you go. And it looks like this. And that's when the NAS ring. That's what that means. If you don't know, that's why we have this here, so you do know. Take a look at it. All right, ASRIP is a candidate default. S is a static, so it's a static candidate default route, okay? S alone is just a static route. So we told her about the 4, we told her about the 1, the 10, the 20, the 30. So we're cool, we're done with router 3, awesome. Router 2 is lucky. Router 2 knows about the 4, knows about the 8. If we look at his routing table, can't do a default route there. Show IP route. So he knows about the 4. He can ping either one. He can ping 10.1.1.10. He can ping that sometime today. Thank you. All right. He can ping that and he can ping his neighbor, which we saw, right? Which is 5. If he shouldn't do an arbitrary ping at one time. All right, so there you go. So he can ping, but he just doesn't know about the VLANs that exist. Okay, so we gotta tell it. Config T, all right, so IP route. I wanna go to the 192.168.1.0. That's a 255.255.255.0 network. And I wanna go out which interface? Well, you wanna go this way, so you gotta go out the G00, correct? Yeah, all right, cool, all right. So G00/0, and administrator is 150, because I want it to be a higher, I want it to be a backup, because I'm gonna create a routing protocol, all right? And then we go up arrow, and then we just change that to 10. And we go up arrow, and we change that to 20. Look how simple that is. That, just keep the same command going out the same way, right? That's the same doorway. That's where all these guys are at. Does that cover everybody? Yeah, VLAN 1, VLAN 10, VLAN 20, VLAN 30. That covers everybody. All right, cool. Now we just told him about all these networks that exist beyond his point. All right? So we say, hey, if you go out this interface, it'll take you to all these VLANs. You're like, oh, man, all right. All right, now this router, if you look at his routing table, all right, do Control Z. Let's do a show IP route. Well, he knows about the VLANs. Obviously, he's routing for them, right? So he knows that, but he doesn't know. He knows about the 4, but he doesn't know about the 8. So that's the only static route we need. Now let's go ahead and configure a default route. Remember, I didn't configure a default route here because you can't. You got 2 ways to go. All right, so I can create just static routes. Here, I'm going to create a default route and just one static route to about this particular network. All right, cool. All right, so we're gonna do that. Let's click in here. So we're gonna do conf t, do IP route 0000000. Well, which way do I go? Well, out your G01, you wanna go this way, go out this way. They'll let you know where you need to go. Oh, okay. So that's the doorway I need to go out by. That's my terminal at the airport. Which is my terminal, I don't know. So that guy is going to give you impact performance, it's fast Ethernet because it creates ARC, you know, and all that good stuff. So, but we're going to create a static route to that network anyway. We're going to do IP route. I want to go to the 10.1.1.8. It has a mask of 255.255.255.252. Out my G0, what was it? G01, okay? Well, /1. And then 150. Always remember to put that 150 if you want it to be a floating route, to be a backup route. You want to go ahead and put that higher administrative distance. 150, WR. All right, so let's see if it's in there. Let's do a show IP route. All right, we see that the gateway of last resort is set. And then there's more, so I'm going to hit space bar to go a page at a time. And there's my default route. And there is my static route that's going to that. So since we're here in this particular router, can we ping 10.1.1.10? That's this particular interface right there. So let's go ahead and do that. We're going to go ahead and ping 10.1.1.10. And let's see. It is the packet trace. Oh, we got a ping. It's behaving. Awesome. All right, well, that's a nice trick. But the point is, can the server get to it? Can the server get to that? Ping, 10.1.1.10. Let's see. Let's go for gusto, man. Request timeout. There we go. We have connectivity all the way across, okay? And that's what you need to do. If you're given a lab, an actual lab where you have to get connectivity, you better ping before you click next, all right? So you see we have connectivity. I'm gonna go to router 3 now, and I'm just gonna ping the other way, all right? I wanna ping VLAN 1, 192.168.168.9.8, come on, 1.2. That's the actual computer that got assigned an IP address. Let's see if it can ping 1.2 from that router. And you can. So you have connectivity. But you know what? Static routes are fine, all right, because they don't have any overhead on your router. There's no bandwidth being taken up. It's more secure because you can control what routes go where and in what direction, actually, you're using static routes. But if you have a lot of routes, man, that's a lot of typing. Hundreds and thousands, of, you know, it's not going to happen. It's a burden on you. So this is where dynamic routing comes in, where you're going to choose a routing protocol. Now, this is a very small network, so we're going to go ahead and configure a routing protocol, like RIP. RIP is a distance vector routing. Forget about RIP version 1, people. It doesn't exist anymore. Whoever using it, it's, you know, like, hello, wake up, okay? Nobody uses RIP version 1 anymore. RIP version 2 or RIP NG for IPv6. So we're going to do RIP version 2, distance vector, maximum 15 hop counts, okay? Unfortunately, it does send its updates out every 30 seconds using a multicast address of 224.0.0.9. Remember that number, 224.0.0.9. Okay, so conf-t, router, RIP. Now, when you did static routes, you told it about networks that existed beyond a certain point. With routing protocols, you're snitching on yourself. It's called routing by rumor. So I'm gonna say, hey man, I'm connected to, I'm advertising my networks. I'm connected to the 10.1. Well, you don't have to say that because it will summarize it. I don't care if you put 10.118, you know, whatever it is, it will summarize it to the class full boundary. If it's a class A, it's the first octet. If it's class B, the first two octets. Class C, first three octets. So don't worry about that. But do not forget. Do not forget that. That's what allows you to have a discontinuous network, and as well, it sends the subnet mask out on the updates. Do not forget no auto summary. All right, cool. So I'm gonna copy that, WR. And here, in the middle router, same thing. Router RIP, did I put version 2 here? Did I put version 2? Look, I didn't do version 2. Here I am talking about, all right, so just type in version 2. We're still inside router configuration mode. Make sure you put version 2. I forgot that. Alright. Version 2. Router RIP. Ver 2. Net. 10000. Is that enough zeros? And then no auto summary. Tab. Tab is your friend. WR. Alright. And then on this network. Now on this network, you gotta advertise these as well, right? The VLANs. So you come over here. Oh no, no, don't go outside the recording here. What are you doing? Oh, I'm sorry. So, config T. All right, router RIP, version 2. Network, okay, let's begin. What am I attached to? Well, I'm attached to the 10.101.4. Let's get that one out of the way. Okay, I didn't have to put that. But I'm glad I did. But so you can see what I mean, that it summarizes it. Okay, now I'm gonna do, I'm also attached to the 192, the 168, the 190. I'm also attached to the 10.0. I'm also attached to the 20.0. I'm also attached to the 30.0. Zero. Jesus. And then no auto summary. Alright, now I'm gonna copy that. Now you do see this, right? 10.114. See that I put 10.114 there? I'm gonna do Control Z. I'll do a show start. And go down, go down, go down, go down. Where's RIP? RIP, 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 RIP. Come on. There's RIP. You see what I mean? It summarizes it. So I don't have to put the whole thing. It's gonna summarize it. Just make sure that you put an auto summary so it sends the subnet mask out on its update. All right, also, if you imagine your whole network is 10, and you don't put an auto summary, it's gonna say, oh, all I see is 10. I don't know. I don't know where to go. All right, so you gotta put an auto summary. So it sends that out there. So let's take a look at the routing table, shall we? Let's go to router 3, all right? Let's see what he sees. What's that? One right there. Okay, do a Control Z. Get rid of all this gibberish. Show IP route. All right, look at that. We're learning about the 1, the 10, the 20, the 30. So router 3 is learning about all these networks. We have a default route or a gateway of last resort is that just in case, and we're directly connected to that. But look, this is the whole thing. Why did the static routes go away? Administrative distance. This is a hop count. So in order to get to the VLANs, you gotta go through two routers, but not to the 114. Yeah, you just gotta go through one router. So again, let's ping 10.1. All right, so 192.168.10.1. Booyah, and we can. So these are things that you need to be aware of, okay? When the routing comes along, you need to decide on a routing protocol. Question that I always ask is, which is the best routing protocol you can use? There is no best routing protocol. It is based on your network, how big your network is, how complex your network is, the type of routers are used, because we all know EHRP is proprietary to Cisco. Yes, I know Cisco opened up EIGRP for other vendors in 2013, but nobody fell in love with it, so nobody's using it like that. All right, their core routers are still running OSPF, but with RIP, using a dynamic routing protocol, you can also use static routes with a higher administrative distance, which are called floating routes or backup routes, in case something would happen to RIP. It goes haywire, it goes crazy. I don't know, somebody takes it out for whatever reason. You have static routes that will back you up, and you still have connectivity with your destination networks. Okay, you can see there are a little lab here. It's getting bigger, it's taking form, because we need to build another side, right? So we can get to that particular side. But another one that I want to show is a nice little show command. And I'll do it from, personal, like you guys would have to do it for your test. It's show IP protocols. And there you see a lot of information about RIP, okay? It is a distance vector routing protocol, so it's sending updates every 30 seconds. These are timers, which you can go ahead and, change. All right, and then it says here, the next one's doing 15 seconds. You have an invalid and a hold down. That means after 180 seconds, that route is invalid. And at the same time, I'm just gonna hold it for 180 seconds, but beyond that, it's invalid. All right, and then if it goes up to 240 seconds, if it goes beyond that, I'm gonna say, you know what? That router doesn't exist anymore. I'm gonna flush it out of it. If you're having bandwidth issues, okay, or flapping interfaces, or whatever the case may be, hardware issues with your interfaces or your cabling, you could increase these timers in order to not send every 30 seconds your entire routing table to your neighbor. All right, because imagine somebody poking you on your shoulder or in your back every 30 seconds, and you turn around and smack them sooner or later. But it tells you that these are your timers, okay? So they do exist, and you can change it within, router RIP version 2, and then you look for your basic timers. All right, it's telling you that you're using version 2, you're sending and receiving version 2. There it is right here on these interfaces. By default, it's using a load balance across four different paths. We're routing for network 10.0.0. This is just router 3. Obviously, that would change if it would be router 1 that we're using for all those VLANs. And then you have your administrative distance, which is 120. So we have connectivity across all our VLANs, and we have connectivity across the entire network. All right, so you build it a step at a time, verify as you go. And when you're taking your certification, do not click that next button until you have connectivity or whatever it is that they wanted you to do. You got to realize what they want you to do in order to be able to go next. Because, and again, they give you 10 minutes per lab simulation, okay? If you take more than 10 minutes and you're seeing that you're not out of time, listen, click next and hope for the best. But I'm sure that, you guys are going to be watching these videos diligently, pausing it, taking snapshots, and practicing by yourself. I'll see you episode.